Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Siege of Fort William Henry, A Year on the Northeastern Frontier, by Ben Hughes. Narrated by Christopher Douyard. It was a feature peculiar to the colonial wars of North America that the toils and dangers of the wilderness were to be encountered before the adverse hosts could meet. A wide and apparently an impervious boundary of forests severed the possessions of the hostile provinces of France and England. The hardy colonist and the trained European who fought at his side frequently expended months in struggling against the rapids of the streams or in effecting the rugged passes of the mountains in quest of an opportunity to exhibit their courage in a more martial conflict. But, emulating the patience and self-denial of the practiced native warriors, they learned to overcome every difficulty, and it would seem that in time, there was no recess of the woods so dark, nor any secret place so lovely, that it might claim exemption from the inroads of those who had pledged their blood to satiate their vengeance, or to uphold the cold and selfish policy of the distant monarchs of Europe. James Fenimore Cooper, The Last of the Mohicans. Prologue. The Southern Shore of Lake George. August 15, 1757. Captain Israel Putnam could smell the dead long before he could see them. Advancing out of the encircling woods, the 39-year-old from Salem, Massachusetts, was lost for words. Fort William Henry was a charred ruin. The ground that 10,000 men had fought over just 1 week before was shrouded in silence, broken only by the occasional cry of squabbling carrion birds. After tearing down the timbers and heaping the corpses upon them, the French had set fire to the ruins, creating a giant funeral pyre. Putnam thought the spectacle too diabolical to be endured. The timbers were still burning, and human carcasses were frying and broiling in the flames. In the woods and marshes and down on the beach by the shores of Lake George, dead bodies lay mangled with scalping knives and tomahawks, and butchered women were still weltering in their own gore. Putnam had last been to Fort William Henry 2.5 weeks before, although raids by the Indian allies of Major General Louis-Joseph de Montcalm had been increasing throughout July. The garrison's commander, Lieutenant Colonel George Monro, seemed to have everything under control. Monro's confidence was understandable. Fort William Henry had been built to the latest design, had a strong garrison, formidable artillery crewed by some of the best gunners in North America, and 3,000 reinforcements under Major General Daniel Webb were just 14 miles away. Nevertheless, 6 days after the French army had begun the siege, Monro found himself in an impossible position. 150 of his men had been killed by sharpshooters, round shot, and shells. His provincial allies were close to revolt. There was still no sign of Webb, and Montcalm's cannons had been dug to within 100 yards of the palisades. His position untenable, Monro was forced to surrender. The following morning, General Montcalm's Indian allies had fallen upon the British column as it made its way, unarmed and defeated, to Fort Edward. A massacre had ensued. As he picked his way through the ruins, staring at the corpses of the men, women, and children he had seen alive just weeks before, Captain Putnam must have been wondering where it had all gone wrong. Introduction. The whole world in flames. 1550 to 1756. The siege of Fort William Henry is a tale of violence, greed, misunderstanding, cowardice, and betrayal. But above all, it relates a clash of civilizations. Three distinct parties were involved: the Europeans, the Indians, and the American colonists. All three had representatives on both sides. The French fought alongside the Canadian militia, Algonquian-speaking tribes of the Pays de Nord, or High Country, and domesticated Indians of the St. Lawrence Valley. The British were supported by provincial militia from Massachusetts, Connecticut, New Hampshire, New York, and New Jersey, and a handful of Iroquois warriors from the Mohawk River Valley. Neither alliance was without difficulties. The European elite lived by an archaic code of honor. They saw themselves as innately superior to the provincials and the savages, and were part of a well-established hierarchy and unquestioningly followed the orders of their kings. The leading Americans, by contrast, were individualists, motivated by financial gain, political and religious freedom, and the acquisition of land. The Indians, for their part, had no understanding of private ownership at all. For them, the land was its own master, a living organism ungovernable by man. And while the warriors had a well-developed sense of honor, their code was very different from the Europeans indeed. To understand how this web of alliances was first spun, it is necessary to look back 200 years before the siege began, a time when North America was still largely untouched by Europeans, a time when fact merged with legend, a time when the Iroquois Confederacy began. In the mid-16th century, Daganoweda, a Huron brave, was born in a village on the northeast shores of Lake Ontario. In his youth, he experienced powerful visions of pan-Indian unity and began traveling through the primordial forests of Northeast America, spreading a mantra of the great law of peace to the scattered warlike tribes. In the Mohawk Valley, in what would become New York State, Daganoweda's preaching found fertile ground and a loose alliance of five Iroquoian nations, the Mohawk, Oneida, Onondaga, Cayuga, and Seneca, was formed. United by a common culture and linguistic roots, the Iroquois Confederacy came to dominate Northeast America. This omnipotence resulted from three factors: the tribe's central location, which gave them access to the Great Lakes via the Mohawk Valley, the St. Lawrence Basin via the Lake George-Lake Champlain corridor, and the Atlantic coast via the Hudson River, the range and impact of the Iroquois raiding parties, and their ability to present a united front, an unprecedented achievement among the anarchic tribes of the region. The first to bear the brunt of the Confederacy's military might were the largely Algonquian-speaking tribes of the Great Lakes region, the Ottawa, Fox, Miami, Nipissing, Potawatomi, Sauk, Huron, and Chippewa. For the next 60 years, they suffered periodic raids by bands of Iroquoian warriors keen to take freshly cut scalps and prisoners of war. Such attacks prompted retaliatory raids, and a state of intermittent hostilities prevailed throughout the 16th century. Although ruthlessly waged, this warfare was more ritual than genocidal, and had little long-term impact on the tribes. At the turn of the 17th century, however, the balance was upset by the arrival of the first Europeans. While explorers had previously had some contact with the Indians of North America's Atlantic coast, the tribes of the interior were largely unmolested by outsiders, until Samuel de Champlain's forays up the St. Lawrence River in 1608. After founding Quebec City, Champlain pushed further into the interior and began exploring the Great Lakes, where he made contact with the Algonquian-speaking tribes. As part of a trade settlement to support the seedling colony of New France, the Indians persuaded Champlain to join a raiding party that would thrust deep into Iroquois territory. At the southern end of Lake Champlain, in the area known as Ticonderoga, the Algonquin warriors and their French allies came across a Mohawk raiding party. Champlain's firearms tipped the balance in the battle that ensued. In consequence, the tribes of the High Country would remain close allies of New France until the colony's eventual destruction in 1760. The Mohawk, on the other hand, would never forget the losses they incurred that day. Thus began their centuries-long grudge against the French. Far to the southeast, a second wave of colonists had arrived. Unlike the French, who had used the St. Lawrence to penetrate far into the interior before founding Quebec, the English developed a string of independent settlements along the Atlantic coast. Jamestown was founded in 1607, Plymouth and Hampton in 1620, and Salem in 1626. The English settlements were radically different in aim and character to those of the French. While the colonists in Quebec, Montreal, and Trois-Rivières integrated with the Indians, converted them to Roman Catholicism, maintained close links with the mother country, and focused on trade rather than territorial acquisition, the English settlements enjoyed considerable freedom from the Edicts of Westminster and prompted a series of wars against the native population as they expanded inland. A further difference was the size of the colony's respective populations. While the influence, if not the dominion of New France, spread over a vast territory throughout the interior, via its trade routes along the St. Lawrence River, across the Great Lakes, and down the Mississippi River as far as Louisiana, by the mid-18th century, its population was just one-tenth of that of the British possessions to the southeast. By the early 1660s, English expansion brought her colonists into conflict with a third European power. The Dutch had been present in the New World since 1614, when a series of settlements were founded along the Hudson River to profit from the fur trade. In 1664, four English frigates sailed into the harbor of New Amsterdam, New York, and demanded its surrender. Principally a mercantile operation, the Dutch colony lacked military might and reluctantly conceded. As well as taking possession of the Dutch forts and villages in the area, the most important of which was renamed Albany, the English also gained control of the region's fur trade. This lucrative business brought them into contact with the tribes of the Iroquois Confederacy, which trapped the furs in the interior, then exchanged them in Albany for the metal trade goods upon which they had come to rely. The items most prized were the knife, tomahawk, and musket. These were not only useful for hunting, but also essential for fighting the Confederacy's ongoing war with the Algonquin tribes of the High Country and their increasingly belligerent French allies. By the late 17th century, the Beaver Wars, circa 1638 to 1701, as they came to be known, had escalated exponentially. What had once been a largely ritual conflict, which enabled young warriors to pass into manhood by demonstrating their martial prowess, had become a war of extermination fueled by European firearms and the merchants' greed for fur. Due to their superior organization and the low price of English trade goods, the Iroquois gained the upper hand. After decimating the fauna of their own hunting grounds, they turned their attention to those of their enemies, and in the process, began wiping out whole communities of Huron, Nipissing, and Potawatomi. At the same time, the Iroquois acted as middlemen, brokering trade deals between the English colonists and the tribes that resided further in the interior. Iroquoian ascendancy in the Beaver Wars brought the inhabitants of New France farther into the conflict, which in turn led the English to become involved. A series of border raids ensued. Led by European colonists with considerable Indian support, these parties penetrated deep into enemy territory, burned settlements, killed those who resisted, and then returned through the wilderness with plunder, captives, and scalps. Across the Atlantic, Europe was also at war. By the end of the 17th century, dynastic disputes had sparked a series of conflicts, fueled by religious intolerance and mutually incompatible colonial ambition. Although each was separated by an uneasy period of peace, the bloodshed would not entirely cease until Napoleon's defeat at Waterloo, 126 years later. The American provincials renamed the first three conflicts after the reigning English monarch of the period. Hence, what was known in Europe as the War of the League of Augsburg, 1688-97, was called King William's War in America. The War of Spanish Succession, 1701-14, became Queen Anne's War, 1702-13, and the War of Austrian Succession, 1740-48, was renamed King George's War, 1739-48. In the colonies, each was a relatively minor affair, and any gains made were often returned as part of the peace treaty discussions that followed. The fourth conflict broke this dynamic. The French and Indian War, 1754-63, would change the face of America forever. The first shots were fired on June 14, 1754. Before dawn, a young Virginian militia colonel named George Washington led a company into the backwoods of the Ohio country. The site of the confluence of two key rivers in the heart of the continent, the region had been the focus of European ambition in America since the mid-1740s. The French sought to build a string of forts across the area that would establish communications between Canada and Louisiana. The British were determined to prevent them. French success would confine King George's colonies to the eastern seaboard and deny them access to the interior. Nevertheless, as war was yet to be declared in Europe, Washington's orders were merely to warn the French off. Alongside his band of Virginians was an indigenous ally whose motivations Washington was yet to fully understand. The man in question was Tana Grissom, a chief of the Mingos, a loosely united tribe made up of various refugee groups that had emigrated to the Ohio country in the mid-18th century. As the Mingos were subordinate to the Six Nations, Tana Grissom had mixed loyalties and was known as the Half-King. By the turn of the 18th century, the Iroquois Confederacy had developed an intricate policy toward the European nations. Unsure as to which power would eventually triumph, the Iroquois simultaneously promised alliances to the British and neutrality to the French, while delivering little to either. By the 1740s, the situation had changed once more. European expansion into the Ohio country was threatening to undermine the Confederacy's monopoly of the fur trade. If the French or British were to attain ascendancy, they would gain greater access to the tribes of the interior, and therefore lessen the influence of the Iroquois. For Tana Grissom and his Six Nations backers, it was crucial that neither side be allowed to gain a foothold in the region. If Tana Grissom were to achieve his aims, he would need to provoke a war between the French and the British that would weaken both while strengthening his own position. The principal victim of Tana Grissom's scheming would turn out to be a 35-year-old Canadian ensign named Joseph Coulon de Villiers de Jumonville. Ordered into the Ohio country by the governor of New France to ascertain British intentions, by the morning of May 28, 1754, Jumonville and his band of 35 colonial regulars, Troupes de la Marine, were preparing to break camp in the bottom of a narrow wooded glen when a noise from above suddenly startled them. Fumbling with his musket, one of the Frenchmen blindly pulled the trigger. Hidden on the flank of a hill above, Washington panicked. Forgetting his orders to repel the French intrusion without bloodshed, he gave the word for all his men to fire. Several Frenchmen were cut down by the volley. The rest betook themselves to flight. Crashing through the undergrowth, they emerged from the glen to find themselves face to face with Tana Grissom's war party. Fearing the Mingos more than their fellow Europeans, the French turned tail, rushed back to Washington, and begged for mercy. The Virginian granted the request, but Tana Grissom had other ideas. Approaching the prostrate Jumonville, who had been wounded by the provincial's opening volley, he drew his tomahawk. After pronouncing, "Thou art not yet dead, my father," he rained a series of blows upon Jumonville's head until his skull had split open. Tana Grissom then took out his brains and washed his hands with them and scalped him. When the French heard of the atrocity, there was no going back. Tana Grissom's plan had worked. The French and Indian War had begun. When news of Jumonville's death reached Montreal, his brother, Louis Coulon de Villiers, was ordered to march to the Ohio country and establish French control. With him, aboard a flotilla of canoes, were a host of New France's Indian allies. Domesticated, or praying Iroquois, who had converted to Catholicism and resettled on the St. Lawrence River, and Huron, Nipissing, and Abenaki from the Jesuit missions to the northeast of Montreal, were joined by wild Algonquian-speaking tribesmen from the High Country. Speeded by a lust for vengeance, Villiers' advance was swift. Within 12 days of his brother's demise, he had arrived at Fort Duquesne, New France's forward base in the region. 2 weeks later, marching through incessant rain, his column reached the scene of Tana Grissom's crime. Under the dripping boughs, several bodies remained unburied. The sight urged Villiers on. The next day, he found Washington's men at a natural clearing known as the Great Meadows, 2 miles northwest of the area that is now Farmington. Having learned of the enemy's presence, Washington built Fort Necessity, a crude palisade ringed by a knee-deep ditch. Dominated by 2 wooded hills within easy musket shot, the fort became a death trap. Of the 350 Virginians and British regulars involved in the fight, 70 fell prey to Villiers' sharpshooters before a truce was called. After a brief negotiation, Washington surrendered. Thanks to his foe's unexpected clemency, the Virginian was allowed to return to his base, 52 miles to the southeast at Wills Creek, his pride bruised, but his scalp intact. The French had won the first round. In 1755, the British raised the stakes. 2 battalions of red-coated regulars, the 44th and 48th, were ordered to sail to America. Their commander, Major General Edward Braddock, was a brave man, but arrogant and of limited vision. He might probably have made a good figure in some European war, an observer opined, but he had too high an opinion of regular troops and too mean a one of both Americans and Indians. Like many of his contemporaries, Braddock believed that open-plan battle tactics would suit the American conflict. But the fields of Flanders were an entirely different prospect to the dark forests of the Ohio country, as Braddock was soon to discover. After arriving at Hampton Roads in Virginia, and enduring a series of exasperating conferences with self-interested colonial governors, Braddock eventually acquired the supplies he needed and set off into the unknown. With 300 axemen at its head, his column, which included 500 provincial troops and militia, cut its way through the wilderness, its mission to destroy Fort Duquesne. Although there was little sign of the enemy, progress was slow. To speed up his march, Braddock decided to divide his force in two. The heavy baggage would travel with the rear division, while a flying column would blaze a trail ahead. Nevertheless, it wasn't until July 9th, a full month after leaving his forward base at Fort Cumberland, that Braddock came within striking distance of his target. For Braddock, the morning of the 9th was the most nerve-wracking of the entire campaign. As the troops of the advance division neared Fort Duquesne, they had to ford the meandering Monongahela River on two separate occasions. Each time as they emerged dripping onto the far bank, they were horribly exposed. But after the second crossing had been completed without interference, Braddock began to relax. It seemed that the French had decided to wait behind their fortifications, and the Indian ambush that his redcoats and militia had feared would not materialize. Unknown to Braddock, however, at that very moment, a force of 900 Indians, Canadian militia, and colonial regulars, led by Captain Leonard de Beaujeu, was advancing through the woods toward them. At 1 o'clock, the two sides met. At first, the battle seemed to favor the British. Blundering out of the woods, the French were met by ordered volleys from Braddock's advanced guard. On the third fire, Beaujeu was killed. His Canadian militia fled, and a young Frenchman, Captain Jean-Daniel Dumas, took command. Stripped to the waist to better enable him to fight in the forest, Dumas, aided by a Canadian Métis of French and Ottawa parentage named Charles Langlade, rallied the Indians and colonial regulars and ordered them to spread out, envelop the column, and take the high ground. The Ottawa, Delaware, Potawatomi, Abenaki, and Ganawage, French-allied domesticated Iroquois who had settled in a series of missions along the St. Lawrence, did not need telling twice. This was the irregular warfare at which they excelled. Crouching behind fallen logs, bushes, and ripples in the ground, they poured a deadly fire into the British column. Schooled in the formal tactics of Europe, Braddock had no reply. Beating those who faltered with the flat of his sword, he insisted that they maintain ranks and answer the scattered marksmen with volleys fired by platoon. Their shots were wasted. Unlike the French regulars and Scottish Jacobites that the veterans among Braddock's redcoats had faced at Laffelt and Culloden, the Indians at Monongahela were like ghosts, flitting from tree to tree through the gun smoke while yelling blood-curdling war whoops. The British rarely saw more than 5 or 6 of them at one time. When the main body of the British column came up, it collided with the advance guard, which had been edging backward, and the troops lost all cohesion. Pushing in on one another to escape the fusillade, they began to panic. Still, Braddock would not countenance a retreat, but when he was finally blasted from the saddle late that afternoon, the British and American soldiers retreated. The Indians rose from the undergrowth to pursue them, and dozens more stragglers were butchered when they reached the Monongahela. Shot through the arm and lung, Braddock lingered on for 5 days. "We shall better know how to deal with them another time," he said before expiring. More than 800 of the 1,300 British regulars and colonial militia under his command had been killed or wounded, as were 63 of the 89 officers involved. As the commander-in-chief of British forces lay dying, a second expedition was about to take place, 400 miles to the northeast. Gathering at Fort Lyman, soon to be renamed Fort Edward on the northern frontier, were 3,500 provincial volunteers from Massachusetts, New Hampshire, New Jersey, Connecticut, and New York, aided by 300 Mohawk warriors. The army was intended for a strike against Fort Saint-Frédéric, a French outpost on Lake Champlain that commanded the overland route to Montreal. The commander of the provincial troops was William Johnson. A 40-year-old of Anglo-Irish origin, Johnson had risen to prominence due to his close links with the Mohawks, among whom he had lived since 1742 as an honorary sachem, with the name of Warahiyage, the man who undertakes great things. By August 28th, Johnson's army had reached the shores of Lake George, known to the French as Lac Saint-Sacrement. While the provincials made camp on raised ground, the Mohawks were sent on scouting missions to gather intelligence. On Sunday, September 7th, after a Calvinist chaplain had preached a sermon from Isaiah, one of the Indians brought news of a large body of the enemy moving from South Bay to Fort Edward. The force, consisting of 600 Indians, 684 Canadian militia, and 216 French regulars of the regiments of Languedoc and La Reine, was commanded by 56-year-old Saxon-born Major General Jean Armand, Baron de Duscoe, the senior regular officer in New France. Having learned of Johnson's plan to attack Fort Saint-Frédéric, Duscoe had decided to preempt him. The next day, the French ambushed a party of 1,200 Mohawks and provincials whom Johnson had sent to reinforce Fort Lyman, halfway between Lake George and that post. King Hendrick, an aging, battle-scarred chief who had once been presented to Queen Anne, had been apprehensive about the mission from the start. "If they are to be killed," he had told Johnson earlier that morning, "they are too many. If they are to fight, they are too few." Nevertheless, Johnson ordered the scouts to proceed. Accepting his fate, Hendrick mounted a horse and went with them. 1 hour later, despite Disco's Ganawage allies attempting to warn their Mohawk cousins, the column fell into a trap. Fired on from high ground on three sides, the Americans and Indians fell in scores. Their leader, Colonel Ephraim Williams, was killed by a musket shot through the head, while Hendrick had his horse shot out from under him and was killed with a bayonet as he lay trapped beneath it. The Mohawk chief was then scalped, the trophy being taken off, not larger than an English crown. The survivors doubled up like a pack of cards and fell back to Lake George. After his Indians had scalped the dead and made prisoners of the wounded, Duscoe pursued them. Having heard the firing that morning, Johnson had ordered his men to construct defenses. By the time Disco's Indians came boiling out of the woods at midday, the provincials were ready. Crouched behind felled trees, rolled wagons, and upturned bateaux, the men from New England held off the warriors and militia, but were powerless to prevent the advance of the regulars from old France. Marching shoulder to shoulder, six abreast down the track from Fort Edward, the white-coated grenadiers came stolidly on. Shot through the buttocks early on in the fighting, Johnson had been replaced by his second, Colonel Phineas Lyman, a lawyer and Yale graduate from Connecticut. Seeing the grenadiers advance, Lyman ordered one of the only British regulars with the expedition, an engineer named William Eyre, to open fire with his four guns, their muzzles thrust between the gaps in the barricades. Firing grapeshot, the guns, one of them a mighty 32-pounder, cut lanes, streets, and alleys through the advancing grenadiers and forced the survivors to withdraw. Although the fighting continued for 4 hours, with the grenadiers' dispersal, the heart had gone out of Disco's men. As dusk approached, they melted back into the woods, leaving the American provincials masters of the field. The Battle of Lake George had been a costly encounter. Both sides lost 250 men. Johnson's plan to advance on Fort Saint-Frédéric was forgotten, and a fort was built by the lakeside to consolidate the position instead. The resulting construction, which Johnson diplomatically named Fort William Henry, after two of the royal family, would mark the extent of Britain's northern ambitions on the American mainland for the next 4 years. 500 miles to the east of Lake George, on the windswept peninsula of New Brunswick, a third action took place during the summer of 1755. Ordered to push the French from the island, Lieutenant Colonel Robert Monckton had been given 200 regulars and 2,000 Massachusetts militia under Colonel John Winslow. On June 6th, after a week-long voyage from Boston, Monckton's troops moved against Fort Beauséjour, a French outpost commanded by Captain Louis Dupont du Chambon de Vergor that dominated the isthmus connecting the peninsula to the mainland. Shortly after the siege began on June 14th, the local militia that had joined Vergor lost heart, marched out of the fort, and surrendered. 2 days later, after a mortar shell had killed six French officers sheltering in a so-called bombproof, the captain and his regulars followed suit. With Vergor's capitulation, the other French forts on the peninsula surrendered, and the British conquest was complete. The population was then forcibly deported. In total, 6,000 men, women, and children were herded aboard waiting transports for repatriation. Some settled in Louisiana, while a few made it to Maryland, where they lived among Roman Catholic co-religionists. Others returned to France. Many more were scattered throughout Britain's American colonies, where they were treated with contempt. Many starved to death or succumbed to disease that winter. Despite Johnson's success and Monckton's victory, 1755 had been a black year for the British. The commander-in-chief had been killed, his redcoats humbled on the Monongahela, and a fourth expedition, an attack against Fort Niagara on Lake Ontario, had gotten no farther than its forward base at Fort Oswego, where the onset of winter had frozen the advancing army in its tracks. The regulars of the 50th and 51st regiments settled in to continue the campaign the following spring. When the winter freeze cut off their supply route up the Mohawk River, they began suffering from scurvy. Dozens died before the thaw brought some relief. Across the Atlantic, Westminster reacted to Braddock's death by appointing a new commander, Lord John Campbell, 4th Earl of Loudoun, a feisty Lowland Scot, set sail for the colonies that spring. With him, aboard a flotilla of transports, were two more regiments of red-coated regulars. One of them, the 35th, or Otways as it was also known, was an inexperienced unit largely composed of impressed men, pardoned criminals, and new recruits. The regiment was destined to take center stage in what would become the most notorious incident of the war. Part 1. The Players and the Stage, 1756 to 1757. 1. The 35th, February to December 1756. Lieutenant Colonel George Monro was a cautious man. Just 2 days before the 35th Regiment of Foot was due to depart from Cork on April 15th, 1756, the 56-year-old had traveled to Dublin to legalize his will, stipulating that his modest estate be divided between his sons, George and Sackville, and his daughter, Jane, in the event of his death. As Monro knew, traveling to North America was a risky undertaking. The British regulars sent out the previous year had suffered badly. Major General Edward Braddock and 300 of his men had been killed at Monongahela, and Indian raids and outbreaks of smallpox were whittling away those based on the northern frontier. To add to Monro's concerns, the 35th was desperately under strength. Of the 1,000 men that regiments were theoretically meant to muster, the colonel had only 496 under his command. Although a few veterans had fought at the bloodbaths of Dettingen and Fontenoy in the War of Austrian Succession, most, including the colonel himself, had never seen action before. As he stood on the deck of the transport sailing out of Cork Bay, Colonel Monro was embarking on the adventure of a lifetime. Born in County Longford, Ireland, in 1700, to a Scottish father of sound military pedigree, Monro was respected by his contemporaries, despite his lack of combat experience. Many thought him a brave officer and a man of strict honor, but his hopes of high rank had been hindered by an undistinguished career. After joining the 35th as a lieutenant in 1718, he had purchased his way up through the ranks, as was common practice at the time, receiving his lieutenant colonelcy on January 4, 1750. The intervening years had been spent on garrison duty. Moving from camp to camp, from Dublin to Belfast, to Cork, to to Kinsale, the men of the 35th passed their days in interminable parades, patrols, and forced marches. Occasionally, the monotony was broken by performing policing duties at riots or minor revolts, or attending regimental and general courts martial. On one particularly memorable occasion in Dublin, one of the regulars had been shot for desertion. Infuriatingly for Monro, but no doubt much to the delight of the crowd, the prisoner, Private James Brooks, who was damningly described as a most abandoned profligate, had refused to play the part of the hand-wringing repentant. All the way from Dublin Castle to the Green, where his executioners awaited with loaded muskets, Brooks had cursed his officers and comrades alike. After a prolonged crossing in transports that stank of the vinegar used to disinfect them, the 35th landed in Plymouth in early March and was assigned barracks for what was intended to be the briefest of stays. The men, and those of the 42nd Highland Regiment of Foot, which would sail with them, were urgently needed in America for an offensive planned for that summer. But William Augustus, Duke of Cumberland, King George II's second son, and Captain General of the British Army, had not counted on the glacial sloth of naval bureaucracy. Not until mid-March did the transports required gather at Plymouth. There they were loaded with Irish butter and beef, colored beads, brass kettles, ivory combs, iron Jews' harps, and other gifts for Britain's Indian allies, and guns for two brigantines being built on Lake Ontario. A few days later, it was noted that the ships had not yet been fitted out to carry troops. An urgent dispatch was sent off, and on April 11th, each man received a small wooden spoon, also a bed, a blanket, rug, and pillows. The troops could then finally embark, but bad weather was to keep them in the bay for 4 more days. Meanwhile, in London, the War Office had put 2 plans into action to bring the regiments bound for America up to full fighting strength. The first allowed for condemned prisoners to receive pardons should they enlist for American service. The other was the second act of impressment to be carried out in 2 years. While Monro and the bulk of the regiment prepared to set sail from Plymouth, Major Henry Fletcher, the Scots second in command, took a detachment of 10 officers and 116 men to London. There, they would collect the impressed recruits assigned to the 35th, who had been gathered near the Savoy Wharf on the Thames. In common with the majority of his commissioned peers, the 33-year-old Fletcher was a purebred gentleman. The second son of Lord Milton, Laird of Salton in East Lothian, and a senior High Court judge, Fletcher had been in the army as long as he could remember. In contrast to Monroe's, Fletcher's career had been one of excitement and rapid promotion, fueled by his father's seemingly bottomless purse, which had seen him serve in a series of different regiments before joining the 35th 2 years before. As a 20-year-old lieutenant, Fletcher had received his baptism of fire at Dettingen under George II. Remembered for being the last time a British monarch led troops into battle, it resulted in an Allied victory over the French, whose youth left more than 1,000 corpses to manure the field. Such a background did little to prepare Fletcher for the scenes that awaited him in London. The Savoy Wharf was seething with impressed men, 471 of whom were destined for the ranks of the 35th. On arrival, Fletcher inspected his regiment's hall. The major was far from pleased. 61 men were immediately dismissed as unfit for service. The rest were transported down the Thames to Gravesend, where ocean-going transports awaited them. The impressment had been carried out with ruthless efficiency, as one of its victims would later attest. For above a year before I left London, the anonymous chronicler, who would go on to fight with the 35th at Fort William Henry, wrote, "I dared not look out at night, nor walk the streets in the day, for fear of being pressed. But it happened to be my turn at last all the same." On April 15th, Monro's detachment finally set sail from Plymouth. 464 strong, the officers and men made the Atlantic crossing in 3 transports, the Essex, the Sydenham, and the Fort Rose. All were dwarfed by their escort, HMS Grafton, a third-rate 70-gun ship of the line. Away from the finely appointed quarters of the senior officers, where servants dished up culinary delights on silver plate, and poured claret into pewter goblets. Conditions on board the transports were appalling. Chickens, dogs, cats, lice, and rats inhabited the dark, fetid spaces below decks, where the sergeants and rank and file were quartered. As the ships were a breeding ground for disease, Thomas Wilkins, the 35th's 44-year-old surgeon, had his work cut out to keep the men and the handful of wives, mistresses, and children who accompanied them healthy. His treatments of emetics, purgings, and bleedings did little good, and by mid-voyage, seven hammocks were occupied by the coughing sick, and the corpse of at least one former patient had been hurled overboard. The men's propensity for sickness was not the only cause of Wilkins's discomfort. While his peers in other regiments had been provided with a complete set of surgical instruments, Wilkins had had to purchase his with funds from his own pocket before leaving Plymouth. 3 months later, Major Fletcher's detachment was finally ready to leave Gravesend. In the interim, the major had a torrid time. Theft was rife among the impressed men. There was a serious threat of mutiny, and living conditions aboard the transports were terrible. In early May, an inspection had been carried out. 25 more men were dismissed as unfit for service as a result. Before they eventually set sail in July, another 3 were claimed by writs, and 6 others had deserted. On the morning of Wednesday, June 16th, Monro's detachment arrived at New York. As the transport sailed by the hook, the shore batteries fired a welcoming salute, and the troops disembarked. In the mid-18th century, New York was the third largest city in British America. Although behind both Boston and Philadelphia in terms of population, it was of primary importance in international trade. More than 200 ships a year unloaded manufactured and luxury items from Europe, such as clay pipes made by William Manby of London, wine from Madeira, and Irish beef and butter, while animal skins and timber from the wild American interior, sugar, cotton, and tobacco from the southern colonies, and mahogany and rum from the West Indies were packed into the holds for the return leg. The officers with Monro, particularly such characters as Captain Charles Ince of the Grenadier Company, a man renowned for his fine voice, great taste, and greater judgment in music, would no doubt have made the most of New York's vibrant cultural scene. Although a far cry from the debauchery and excesses of Georgian London, the city offered the men a last chance for a fine meal, a concert, or a visit to a brothel before they were shipped up the Hudson to the cultural backwaters of Albany and beyond. Those of a more pious bent were equally catered for. New York boasted several fine churches of all denominations, including a Quaker meeting house and a synagogue. At night, merchants' carriages rattled down the spacious, tree-lined streets, and promenading couples listened to the amorous music of native tree frogs, which, according to a visiting Swede, made such a din that it was difficult for a person to make himself heard. For the lower ranks in the 35th, New York also held its attractions, and for at least one, they proved too much to resist. On June 21st, John Clark, a 25-year-old private from Northwich, whom Monro later described as round-visaged and of a swarthy complexion, slipped out of the regiment's temporary barracks and deserted. Despite Monroe's efforts to trace him, Clark was never found. 5 other privates were discharged at New York as unfit for duty, and 2 were sent to the hospital. The day after Clark absconded, the 35th and 42nd Regiments boarded 20 sloops for the 150-mile journey up the Hudson to Albany, the major staging post for the campaigns being fought on the northern frontier. The journey was a pleasant one. Fresh provisions of greens, roots, and ship's beer were issued, and on their way upriver, the sloops were accompanied by playful porpoises tumbling end over end, 6-foot flat-nosed sturgeons, which were easily caught, and clouds of fireflies that would settle on the rigging at night. At times, the tide was too strong to proceed by sail, and the captains would order the men to man the oars or lower the anchor until the worst of the current had passed. For the first 20 miles, the eastern bank was dotted with farmhouses surrounded by plowed land. But afterward, signs of civilization became increasingly infrequent. On the 4th and final day of the journey, however, cultivated fields, littered with strange cone-shaped haystacks, The stone and timber dwellings of the Dutch inhabitants of Upper New York passed into view. The walled town of Albany, founded by the Dutch 150 years before, was beautifully situated. Built on the slope of a hill, it overlooked the river and was framed by the mountains that arose up beyond it in the west. Two stone-built churches dominated the center of town. One was English, overseen by the Reverend John Ogilvie. The other was a three-story Dutch building. Both were built on State Street, the principal avenue, which was five times as broad as the other thoroughfares, and served as a marketplace on weekends. The houses on the lesser streets, where the farmers let their cattle graze in the summer evenings, were equally charming. Built in the Flemish style, they had gables notched like steps, and idiosyncratic weather vanes adorned with horses, lions, and geese. Outside the walls on a second hill, steeper and higher than the first, stood a fort, a great building of stone, surrounded with high and thick walls. Although only inhabited by 329 families, Albany was the foremost British military staging post in Northern America due to its location on a vital river confluence. 5 miles to the north, the Mohawk flowed into the Hudson. Further upstream, it flowed by the hilltop fortresses of the Mohawk Indians, and near its source at the Finger Lakes, it passed within miles of Fort Oswego, a flashpoint on the ill-defined Anglo-French border and the gateway to the Great Lakes. 2 days' march to the north of Albany, the Hudson led to Fort Edward, from where it was a 14-mile trek via a rough-cut forest road to Fort William Henry. Situated on the shores of Lake George, and just 1 day south of the French outpost of Fort Carillon by birch-bark canoe, William Henry was the northernmost point of the British frontier in mainland America. While the Dutch inhabitants, with their outdated dress, indecipherable language, fat mistresses, and uncouth sort of dancing were strange enough, the most remarkable thing about Albany for the men of the 35th were the groups of Mohawk Indians who came into town to cash in beaver skins trapped in Canada, or the freshly cut scalps of French officers taken from the wilds around Fort Carillon. Dressed in highly decorated moccasins and buckskin breechclouts, which left their haunches bare, the Mohawks were heavily tattooed and painted. Their necks and ears were festooned with looped brass jewelry, and their heads clean-shaven, aside from a central tuft of hair that they dyed orange, blue, or red. Among the most feared warriors of all the six nations of the Iroquois Confederacy, the Mohawks bristled with muskets, tomahawks, ball-headed maple clubs, and hunting knives, which they carried in sheaths strung around their necks. In July, having set up a sea of tents, nicknamed Camp Mohawk, at Pine Island on a hill overlooking the town, Monro began preparing his men for action. The first stage was intensive training. Mr. Welch, a corporal renowned for his skills on the parade ground, drilled the men daily. While the rank and file sweated their way to a mastery of battalion and company formations, the senior officers entertained themselves by hunting in the nearby forests, or riding on countryside jaunts. On July 8th, Major General James Abercrombie, second in command of all British forces in North America, decided to visit the Cohoes Falls, an impressive natural phenomena and sacred site for the Mohawks, 10 miles to the north of Albany. As Indian raiding parties had been known to travel through the area, Abercrombie took an escort of 24 men from the 42nd and 35th. That morning, it was excessively hot. As the column reached the falls, Abercrombie was perspiring mildly on his horse, while his escorts, dressed in the thick red woolen coats, shirts, and breeches of the regulars, were on the point of expiring. Half mad with the heat and his head full of nightmares of Indians torturing their captives in the woods, one of the Highlanders imagined he saw someone watching them. Unslinging his musket, he aimed at the apparition, but before he could draw his trigger, he fell down dead. According to a local paper, two more belonging to the 35th fell down after the same manner and expired immediately, and 13 others fainted away, but were later brought to by being bled. When not drilling or escorting senior officers, the 35th practiced blazing off volleys of platoon fire or shooting at marks. Even this was not without incident. On July 12th, while a company was loading for target practice, a soldier's gun went off by accident and shot two of them through the thighs. The Brown Bess musket, standard army issue of the period, fired a low-velocity, 69-caliber lead ball and was often lethal at close range. Fortunately for the two privates, neither wound proved fatal. Nevertheless, life was cheap in the 18th century, and mortal accidents were all too common. Just over 2 weeks later, on Tuesday, July 20th, with temperatures still in the mid-90s, the members of an artillery train passing through Albany decided to pause for a swim in the river. As a local newspaper nonchalantly reported, one was taken with the cramp and drowned. At the end of July, Lord Loudon, the newly appointed commander-in-chief of British forces in America, arrived in Albany. Traveling with the 52-year-old was an impressive personal entourage, which included a mistress and no less than 17 secretaries. A rough Scotch lord, hot and irascible, Loudon was an energetic and effective administrator, but his haughty and autocratic manner ensured he would clash with his provincial subordinates from the start. His first duty was to assume command from William Shirley, the governor of Massachusetts. Next, he attempted to heal a rift between the regulars and provincial troops, which had been growing since 1755. The law stipulated that provincial commissions, issued by the relevant colonial governor, would at all times be subordinate to those supplied to regulars by the king. In effect, this meant that a senior provincial officer, such as Major General John Winslow of Massachusetts, currently commanding the army defending Forts Edward and William Henry, would be outranked by the most junior ensign of the 35th. The provincial officers found this unacceptable, and Winslow warned that his entire army would dissolve if the law was put into effect. Loudon was willing to compromise. Before leaving Britain, he had ensured that the law was modified, and now high-ranking provincials would be counted as senior captains when serving alongside their British counterparts. Loudon thought this was a most magnanimous concession. Winslow and his fellow provincials failed to agree. The argument regarding seniority was but one of Loudon's problems with his American troops. Essentially, the disagreement stemmed from the failure of both parties to understand the starting viewpoint of the other. Loudon saw the provincials as no different than any other British subjects, and therefore felt that they must subjugate any personal whims to the will of the crown. The provincials, by contrast, felt they deserved a measure of independence when managing what they saw as their own affairs. Although they still thought of themselves as British, the vast distance between themselves and their monarch, and Westminster's policy of allowing the colonists de facto autonomy, had led to the formation of some decidedly republican ideas. As well as having to put up with what he saw as Winslow's seditious demands, Loudon was required to deal with a civilian population that insisted on negotiating his every command, and refused to comply with any request for aid or supplies without being compensated. Even by American standards, the Dutch inhabitants of Albany, whose predecessors had been forced to take the oath of allegiance in 1664, when Amsterdam's colonial pretensions had been crushed by the English, were hardly the most willing of King George's subjects. Besides maintaining their own culture, language, and religion, they charged the redcoats astronomically high prices for provisions, while continuing a highly lucrative, though illegal, trade with New France. Furthermore, rumors were rife that a number were spying for Montreal. According to a note written by Loudon in August 1756, one Henry Lydius, whom we suspect for a French spy, lives better than anybody, without any visible means, and his daughters have often had presents from Mr. Vaudreuil, the governor of New France. All of this resulted in a mutual antipathy between the British and the Dutch, which occasionally boiled over into brawls. One example of this disharmony directly impacted on the 35th. Although the regiment was comfortable enough in Camp Mohawk during the summer months, come winter, its soldiers would need more permanent accommodation if they were not to be decimated by cold and disease. When Loudon announced his intention to quarter them on the civilian population, there was uproar. The mayor, a 48-year-old father of seven named Sybrand G. van Schaik, whose great-grandparents had emigrated from Utrecht in 1637, was the first to voice his displeasure, dramatically declaring that he would sooner die than submit. By calling Loudon's bluff, Von Schaik was making a grave mistake. The Scot had a fiery temperament, and this latest example of colonial impertinence pushed him to the limit. Replying that he could not be expected to prevent the mayor's martyrdom, Loudon promptly marched his troops into Von Schaik's house on Market Street. Von Schaik backed down, and Loudon responded by announcing three concessions. British officers, unlike sergeants and rank and file, would have to pay for their own board and lodging. The crown would supply the regulars firewood and bedding. And a new barracks would be built, also at King George's expense, to prevent such difficulties in the future. Matters then appeared to improve. But the insolence of a Canadian trader resident in town later induced Loudon to reverse the first of these proposals. When required to house a British officer, the Canadian responded by throwing his baggage into the street and barricading the door. Loudon was determined to have the last word. "I sent a file of men and put the officer in possession of the house," he explained in a letter to Lord Cumberland. "If I find any more of this work, whenever I find a leading man shut out any of the people, I resolve to take the whole house for a hospital, or a storehouse, or let him shift for himself." In mid-August, disastrous news came from the west. The French had taken Fort Oswego. Before Loudon's arrival, Governor Shirley had planned to use the outpost as a springboard for that summer's campaign to capture an enemy fort at Niagara. But the forces of New France had preempted the move. Whereas the general assemblies of the 13 colonies that made up British America were ruled by self-interest, New France was an autocracy, with supreme power resting in the hands of just one man, the governor, Pierre-François de Rigaud, the Marquis de Vaudreuil. While first Shirley and then Loudon had been battling with the colonial councils in an attempt to secure the funds, supplies, and provincial troops needed to launch a campaign against Niagara, Vaudreuil had simply ordered an attack on Oswego, and New France had followed his command. The Marquis de Montcalm, commander-in-chief of all French regulars on the continent, had massed his troops before Lieutenant Colonel James Mercer, commander of the garrison at Oswego, had even been aware of his intentions. On August 12, 1756, just a month after leaving Quebec, Montcalm besieged Oswego with 3,000 regulars, Canadian militia, and Indian auxiliaries. The defenders were hopelessly outnumbered. Their defenses were poor, and they had been weakened by a particularly cruel winter, exacerbated by a lack of rations and frequent outbreaks of scurvy. On the 14th, after 2 days of raids on outposts and withdrawals as the French edged ever closer, Mercer had been beheaded by a French cannonball while directing the fire of a counter-battery. His decapitation proved the final straw. The surrender was signed shortly afterward by Mercer's deputy, Lieutenant Colonel John Littlehales, and almost the entire garrison was led away as prisoners of war. As a few men who had escaped limped into Albany in the weeks that followed, further details emerged. One told of how Montcalm's Indians had fallen on the sick and wounded following the capitulation. They behaved like infernal beings, rather than creatures in human shapes. They scalped and killed all the sick and wounded in the hospital, mangling, butchering, cutting, and chopping off their heads, arms, and legs with the utmost cruelty, notwithstanding the repeated intercessions of the defenseless for mercy. Another eyewitness recounted that one of those murdered that afternoon, Lieutenant de la Court, had only just had his wounds dressed before being cut to pieces. Even disregarding the news from Oswego, September 1756 was a black month for the 35th. Things began to go wrong on the 4th with the arrival of Major Fletcher and his detachment of impressed men. Of the 376 who had sailed from London, only 351 remained when they reached Albany. Six had died at sea, and 19 had been left sick in New York. Together with Monro's detachment of 400 and the 150 veterans who had been assigned to Fletcher to keep control of the impressed men, the 35th was now 900 strong. On the morning of September 5th, Monro held a regimental parade that saw his regiment united for the first time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.